And now in the name of our loving, liberating, and life-giving God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Well, good morning, Fort Worth. It is a joy and a privilege and a distinct honor to be with you for this gathering. As your bishop said, if you couldn't tell by the hymns, these are grandma's hymns. And if you're singing grandma's hymns, that means it must be a revival. Must be. And it really is a joy and a privilege to be with you to give God thanks for God's revival. And as Bishop Mayer said yesterday in an incredible homily, for resurrection among us through you. And I must say that you, through many dangers, toils, and snares, you have borne witness that in days sometimes when hope unborn had died, you have borne witness that God is still in our land and that the way of the cross, the way of Jesus, is the way of love. And you have borne witness to that and reminded all of us in the Episcopal Church that we follow Jesus, who taught us the way of love, and we are today the Episcopal branch of the Jesus movement. That's who we are. That's who we are. And so I thank you and bring you the greetings of your brothers and sisters, the rest of the Episcopal branch of the Jesus movement. I talked with one of them yesterday by text. Her name is Gay Clark Jennings, the president of the House of Deputies. And she and I text regularly. And yesterday we were texting about something. And she said, "Where are you?" And I said, "I'm in the Diocese of Fort Worth." And she texted back immediately, "I love the people of the Diocese of Fort Worth and Bishop Scott Mayer, their bishop." So on behalf of President Jennings, on behalf of the House of Deputies, the House of Bishops, on behalf of the some nearly 2 million Episcopalians, which is a number that we can't completely trust because clergy actually came up with it. But on behalf of all of them, it is a privilege and a joy. I am so glad to be here with you. I don't know what to do. I'm glad to be here with you. I hope you're glad to be here. It's good to be here. Now, I have a funny feeling I'm going to get exercise on these. Well, praise the Lord. Just praise the Lord. Allow me, if you will, to offer some reflections on the theme that you've been living with, and that yesterday I know Kathy Comer, I don't know where Kathy is, but we got to get her recorded, because I got a feeling she could get people actually listening to the scriptures. Just let her tell the story. And for these 2 days, many of you have been wrestling with how do we tell our own stories of faith, our personal stories in your way that's authentic to you, that's not mimicking somebody else, but the stories of how God, how Jesus, how the Holy Spirit has been moving in your life. Because I dare say that I don't think I've ever argued anybody into faith. My argument doesn't really work. And the truth is, when you look at the New Testament and the Acts of the Apostles, when Peter got up on that day of Pentecost, he didn't actually give a learned dissertation. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. I know there's some scholars here, and we're near a divinity school. Nothing wrong with that. But he told his story. And when Peter told his story, and how the story and the reality of the risen Jesus came into his life, those stories touched other people's stories. And that's when lives started to change. So old folk used to sing, my grandma and probably yours too, so used to sing that song that said, I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme and glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. There is an old, old story, and it is the story of Jesus and his love. And that's our game changer. So let me offer a text. It comes from the end of John's Gospel, chapter 20, where John brings, I'm going to just come on down. This is going to drive me crazy. It comes from the end of John's Gospel, chapter 20. Now, if you look at John's Gospel carefully, you'll notice that it actually ends at chapter 21. Now, John concludes the Gospel with the text I'm about to give you, but then he goes on and tells some more stories of the risen Christ, of Jesus raised from the dead. And scholars have, and I know there's some biblical, where is she? Oh, yeah, there's some biblical scholars in the room. So I have, and the Bishop of Dallas is a theologian, so I need to be careful. I know that. And I know that the scholars debate the reason for the additional ending, chapter 21. Why doesn't the Gospel just end at chapter 20? But I'm a preacher, and I know what it was. I know the sermon was coming to a conclusion, and John thought about something else and took that plane back on up for one more try. That's what's going on. But at the conclusion, or the original conclusion, John, having told the story of Jesus, then says this. Now, Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, referring to the gospel. But I have written these things. I have told you these stories so that you might come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and might have life in his name. There are many other things I could have written about him. I mean, Jesus did a whole lot. This brother was awesome. We're talking about the Son of God. I mean, this is like some real high, this is high cotton, you know? There are many other things I could have told you, many other miracles he performed, many other lives that he touched, but I've written these few things so that you might believe. I've told you these stories so that you might believe and encounter him and his life encounter you, and that your lives might be changed, that you might be loved and then liberated by that love for life. Told you the stories of how his story, notice in John's Gospel, and it's true in the others, how the story of Jesus intersects with the story of the people in the gospel story. And when his story and their stories intersect, a new story gets written. Think back in chapter 3, for example, of John's Gospel, where Jesus runs into Nicodemus. Now, I like to think of Nicodemus as the first Episcopalian. Let me tell you why. Remember, you know, the story of Nicodemus in John 3. Nicodemus comes to Jesus, and he's a Pharisee. I mean, he's kind of in the ruling party. And he comes to Jesus, and he comes to him by night, John says, because he didn't want anybody to see him coming to Jesus. I said, that is so Episcopalian. Somebody want to get close to Jesus, but you don't want nobody to know about it. That is so us. I mean, it is. And yet Jesus and Nicodemus have this conversation, and they get into a deep conversation, because they get into a conversation not only about life, but how do you actually find life? And I think Nicodemus was trying to keep it on an intellectual level, again, a sign of an Episcopalian again, trying to keep it on an intellectual level, but Jesus tells him, no, that's not going to get it, brother. We got to go deeper. Let's go deep into your origins, deep into who you are, deep, 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 until you are born anew and find life. When the story of Jesus and the story of Nicodemus met, a new story got written. And if you look at the end of the gospel, Nicodemus was there with Joseph of Arimathea to make sure that Jesus had a proper burial. Little did he know, though, that Jesus wasn't going to stay in the grave. But that's another story. But if you go on even further, go into the fourth chapter of John, and I'm not going to go through the whole, yes, I am. But But if you go to the fourth chapter, you get Jesus meeting this Samaritan woman by the well. And what's really going on there is that was a conversation between those two, a conversation that wasn't supposed to happen by the structure and nature of the world. First off, he was a man and she was a woman. And he was a Jewish rabbi. And a Jewish rabbi in first century Palestine was not supposed to be talking to no sisters in the middle in public. That was just the nature of that's just the way it was. But more than that, Jews and Samaritans did not get along. This is basically Israelis and Palestinians. That's what's going on. This was a conversation that the structures of the world and reality were not to make, and yet Jesus and this woman have this conversation. And the nice thing is, I'll let you go home and read it for yourself, but it's in John 4, they get into each other's business. They start talking about drinking some water, and Jesus says, well, why don't you get me some water? She says, that well is deep, and I don't have anything to dig with. He said, yeah, you better believe the well is deep, but I'm not talking about that well. I'm talking about the deep well inside of you that's below all of the hurt, that is below all of the pain that's been part of your life. He said, that's the well I'm talking about. And when we get down deep into your story and into your life, you're going to discover that there's been a God there all along trying to love you and trying to care for you. And when you get in touch with that God there, you're going to find an inner well that is so powerful, it will well up into eternal life. And the more those two talked, oh, the more they got it together. At one point, Jesus says to her, go on and call your husband. And the sister says, well, I don't have a husband. Jesus said, yeah, you're right, you don't have a husband. You had a whole bunch of them, and that joker you with now is not your husband. And we thought new morality was something new. But don't feel sorry for this sister, because she pivots quickly and immediately says, sir, I perceive you must be a prophet. And so all of a sudden now she's getting in Jesus' business, and she turns the tables. Instead of on her story, she gets into his story. And it goes back and forth like that until eventually her story actually meets the depth of his story. And when those two stories meet, a new story gets written. And that woman becomes the first evangelist. She goes back and tells folk about this Jesus. I met a man who did not want to abuse me. I met a man who actually loved me for who I am, who respected my God-given dignity. I met a man unlike anybody I have ever met before. He must be the Messiah, the Christ. Oh, John was telling you, there are so many other stories I could tell you. Could tell you about the folk who broke five loaves of bread and two pieces of fish, and Jesus went and fed folk and then preached, I am the bread of life. Could tell you the story about the Jesus telling the story of the sheep, I am the good shepherd, and I have come that you might have life and not have bargain basement life, but have real life, not life you can barter for on eBay, but real life. Life abundant, life of integrity, life of dignity, life of vitality. I've come to show you the way to live. And then he raises Lazarus from the dead. I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me shall not die. Even though they die, they will live forever. I am the way, the truth, the life. I'll show you a life, because when your story meets my story, a new story gets written and you get set free. Grandma used to sing it this way, I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. Oh, his eye is on the sparrow and I know he watches me. Am I on target? Are we getting close? You see, if you think about it, this is the way God has often worked. It's not anything to do. Jesus was picking up a long and ancient tradition. Because if you look, even in the Old Testament, you find the same thing. Remember Moses? I don't mean did you know him personally. I mean, try it this way. Remember Charlton Heston? Remember the Ten Commandments? Remember, there's this wonderful in the third chapter of Exodus where, remember, Moses has been fleeing. Remember, he had been in Egypt, and he's fleeing Egypt. The Hebrews were slaves in Egypt. He's fleeing Egypt, and eventually he settles down around Mount Sinai, and he marries a woman there, Jethro's daughter, and all that stuff. And he's doing fairly well, but he's kind of running from who he is. And but eventually, while he's there one day, he's tending the sheep and all that kind of stuff, and he sees up on the mountain, there's a mountain volcano called Sinai, other traditions call it Horeb, and he sees up on that mountain, he sees a fire, and he goes up to investigate and looks, and as he sees the fire, he realizes that it's a bush, and it's on fire, but the fire is not destroying it. And he approaches it, and he hears a voice. An old song, "Something within me that holdeth the rain. Something within me I cannot explain. All I know is there's something within." And that something within speaks, "Moses, Moses, take off the shoes from your feet. For the ground on which you are standing is holy ground." "Who are you?" "I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob." I knew them, and I know you, Moses. What do you know about me? I know you're running from yourself. What do you mean running from myself? This all isn't actually in the Bible, but if you read between the lines, this is what they meant. I mean, I think the rabbis call this midrash. This is Michael's midrash, reading between the lines. And he said, "Well, what do you mean you know me?" He says, "I know who you are, Moses, and there's a part of you that's running from your own story. You're running from the depth of who you actually are." "What do you mean I'm running from that?" You're running because you were born from Hebrew slaves, and your mama put you in the water in the Nile River, and your big sister Miriam watched over you, and there was a woman who took you, a princess of Egypt, and she took you out of the water, and she raised you as her child, and your mama came and nursed you. You actually had two mothers. I'm gonna leave that one alone. I'm just saying, Moses had two mothers. I'm gonna leave that one right where it is. It's in the Bible. Just leave it there. He said, "Yeah, you got two mothers, and one of them by birth, one of them by adoption, and they both loved you. You were born a Hebrew slave, and yet you were raised as a prince of Egypt. And you're confused about your identity. I understand, but I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I'm the God of Abraham and Sarah and Hagar. I'm the God from whom Jews, Christians, and Muslims will come from Abraham, Sarah, and Hagar. I'm the God. I'm their God. That's who I am, and I know who you are. And you're confused. And in the conversation that you can read between the lines, God actually was telling his own story. And Moses' story got told. And that's why God told Moses, now you got to take off the shoes from your feet. Because when someone tells the real story, we call that a revelation, an unveiling to the deep truth of who we are. And when that happens between us, we are standing on holy ground. And when that happens, miracles are possible. Elie Wiesel, great Jewish prophet, survivor of the Holocaust, Nobel Prize winner. One of his stories it's a story actually from Eastern Europe, Judaism. In one of his books, he tells this story of this little tiny Jewish community that was periodically threatened with danger. And when the danger would come, it was an old rabbi, this is probably in the Middle Ages, old rabbi would go out into the forest to a certain place, and when he found that special place, he would say a certain prayer, and he would light a fire. And when he did that, the miracle happened. And the danger was averted. And the people were saved. A generation later, things went along fine, and then all of a sudden, the danger came back again a generation later, and another rabbi, remembering what the old rabbi had done, it's kind of like apostolic succession, remembering what the old rabbi, the difference is we don't remember, but anyway, that's a whole nother, remembering what the old rabbi had done, he knew, he went out into the forest, because the people were in danger, went out into the forest, he found that certain place, he lit the fire, but he couldn't remember the prayer. But that was all right, because he had found a certain place, and he had lit the fire, and the miracle happened, and the danger was averted. Things went along okay for a while, and then a generation later, same thing happened again. This time the community was in danger, and another rabbi in the lineage of the other rabbis went out into the forest, and he found a certain place, but he couldn't remember the prayer, and he didn't know how to light the fire, but just because he went and found a certain place, the miracle happened, and the danger was averted. Things went along well, went along just fine for a while, and then lo and behold, the same thing happened again, and this time another rabbi went out, but he couldn't remember where to go. He didn't know where the certain place was. He didn't know how to light the fire. He didn't know how to say the prayer. He just went and told everybody what the old rabbis did, and when he told the story, the miracle happened. The danger was averted. The truth is, when our story meets the story of another, and when those stories meet the story of God, miracles can happen, and maybe the danger can be averted. We've just come through a difficult period in our cultural life, a period, a time, I believe, where the very democracy in which we live has been endangered by the divisions that are among us in America. There is nothing wrong with differences, but division, that is painful. And we experienced it during and after our election in November. Now, it doesn't matter whether you're Republican or Democrat, blue or red or something in between. I dare say we probably would agree that our recent election was really a time of division in our country. It was epitomized, if you will, during the actual presidential campaign itself. And on one instance, it became clear how deep the divisions were. On March 10th in 2016, in Fayetteville, North Carolina, there was a rally, and presidential candidate Donald Trump was doing his thing, and his supporters were doing their thing. And there were protesters at the rally, and they were doing their thing. And it became hot, dangerous, and on the border of violence. Eventually, law enforcement came in to kind of remove the protesters before things really exploded. And as they were walking the protesters out, a man named John Franklin McGraw, who was a white guy, I need to say that, just it's part of the story. But anyway, he's a white guy, and he was a Trump supporter. And he jumped out at one of the protesters, who happened to be a guy named Raheem Jones, who was a black guy. I mean, they're both still white and black, but they were then too. So anyway, McGraw jumps out at Raheem and punches him in the face. And you can actually see this. It's on YouTube. It was caught on somebody's cell phone. And he punched him in the face, and he was arrested as well. And after he was arrested, or while he was walking out, this is what he said. He said he deserved it. The next time we see him, we might kill him. We don't know who he is. He might be a terrorist. Notice the language. We don't know who he is. He might be a terrorist. when we don't know who we are, when we don't know each other, then the unthinkable becomes thinkable. Telling stories is not just telling stories. It's about knowing who we are. Anyway, the story doesn't end there. A few months later, there was an arraignment in court, and McGraw and Jones were both present for the arraignment for McGraw, and he was being sentenced. He was sentenced to 30 days in prison or in jail and 12 months probation. At that time, things had cooled down a little bit, and the two men faced each other in the courtroom, and you can see it on YouTube. They stood and faced each other. And McGraw then said to Jones, "If I had met you on the street, I expect the same thing would have happened. But now I would have told you to go home, because one of us would get hurt. That's what I would have said. But you know what? We are caught up in a political mess today, you and me. And we got to heal our country. My brothers and sisters, we are caught up in a political mess today, you and me. And we gotta heal our country. We gotta heal our country for ourselves, for our children, for generations yet unborn. And I really believe that the way to that healing," stay with me, I'm coming to it now, "is by a revival of relationships between people who don't know each other. You wanna cross the racial divide? Cross the bridge and get to know somebody. You wanna cross the political divide? Cross the bridge and get to know somebody. I wanna suggest, I wish I could get to Congress, because what I would tell them, brothers and sisters, it's time for, oh, help me somebody. It is time for a Republican to learn how to love a Democrat and a Democrat to learn how to love a Republican. And if you think it's hard, go, and it may be hard when you just talk about politics, but go to that Democrat or go to that Republican and actually listen to their story. Find out something about them. And let them find out something about you. And the truth is, when you start hearing the story of somebody else and they start hearing your stories come together and a new story tends to get written. Because I can only, well, it's easy for me not to like you until I get to know you. It's true, right? I mean, think about it. And then when I get to know you, I say, "Oh, darn, I really wanted to dislike you. And now, I mean, you know, messed it up." Because what's going on here is that our stories are, that's who we really are. And the deeper you go, I'm not talking about the shallows, the deeper you go, you actually run into somebody who's just like you, who has the same fears and the same hopes and the same dreams. And they may be a Democrat, they may be a Republican, they may be a liberal, they may be a conservative, they may be, who knows, they may be black, white, red, yellow, brown. But they're a child of God just like you. And when we discover that, a new story gets written. And maybe, I'm going to stop in a minute. I am. And I can't go past here because Katie's camera's right here. And if I go past here, then but when we do that, a new story gets written. And when that new story gets written, then the story of this very democracy gets rewritten. And if the story of this democracy can be written, then maybe the story of this world can be rewritten. And maybe we can learn how to lay down our swords and shields down by the riverside and study war no more. Maybe. Well, I'm going to bring this to a conclusion now, and I really am. And well, you know the definition of an optimist, that when a preacher says, "and in conclusion," that's not just a metaphor, but I really am going to conclude. Some years ago, I was the rector of St. James Church in Baltimore, Maryland, an old Episcopal church dating from 1824. It was actually a church that was founded by a group of both slave and free Africans, blacks, living in Baltimore at the time. So it's an old place, wonderful, wonderful old congregation, but in Center City, Baltimore. If you've ever seen the show The Wire, if you remember that show, some of the scenes were actually filmed at St. James, which lives, inhabits a really tough neighborhood in the city of Baltimore, but a wonderful city and good folk. While there, the neighborhood where the church was one that was heavily crime-infested and drug-infested. This was in the late 80s, early 90s, when soon after crack cocaine had hit the street, and my guess is you had the same experience in Fort Worth, and all of our cities were impacted. Now we're seeing heroin all over the country. I mean, they're talking about it in Maine. I mean, this is the drug realities are real, and we got to find a way to heal our country. But anyway, at that time, it was crack cocaine. And because of crack cocaine, there were drug cartels. Where there were drug cartels and gangs, there's going to be violence. And the drive-by shootings were escalating, and the stench of death was rising. Even as a parish priest, I was burying young men, some of whom had grown up in St. James as acolytes. Anyway, during this time, a group of us ecumenically came together trying to figure out what can we do as a group of pastors, and we got together with the neighborhood association and with others, and somebody had the bright idea. They said, you know, we know where the drug dealing is. We know some of the key areas where there are, so why don't we take the gospel to the streets? And, you know, those of us who were mainline, you know, church folk were thinking, take the gospel to the streets. I mean, I know the hymn, we're across the crowded ways of life, but I didn't mean it to be taken literally. But anyway, so we were kind of thinking, well, what do you mean by that? And one of the pastors, I think it was a Pentecostal pastor, said, we need to have a revival in the street. Stop having the revivals in our churches. Let's take the revival to the street. And I remember thinking, oh, man, I am way out of my element. They didn't teach me anything about this in the Episcopal Seminary. And so we kind of agreed that what we were going to do was kind of take mini revivals. I mean, they weren't full-blown revivals. They did become full-blown revivals later, but we were going to go out, and they said we were going to do street corner witnessing. Well, none of us knew how to do that. I mean, from the main lines, we were Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, Episcopalian, Roman Catholic. I mean, we were sort of the mainline gang, and we had all been taught, you know, you're supposed to be up there in the pulpit, and we know how you can lean on the pulpit and how you can do this and that, and you got everything you got to say in a text in front of you. What are you supposed to do on a street corner? So there was a Pentecostal pastor who, he knew what to do on a street corner, and so he kind of taught us all how to do it. And needless to say, we were all scared to death to get out there. But all it was he said, just say a little bit of your own story. Now, I'm not 10. Y'all need to do that. That's not what my point. Don't get worried. That's not what I'm talking about. But anyway, we started every Friday this went on for a number of years, going on street corners. Somebody would share a personal story, something from the gospel. And then we would sing and pass out literature, people who wanted to get in touch with rehab programs and all sorts of, we did literature and resourcing of the community as well. And we made sure that the police knew what we were doing. And, you know, this went on for a while, and it was symbolic to be sure, but symbols help. And so this went on for a while, and one day I was in the office at the church, and Ms. Savage, the assistant, came in and said, there's a young man here to see you. And I said, well, okay, sure, have him come on in. And he came in, and when I saw him come in, I realized who he was. I mean, I knew his face and knew of him, didn't really know him. He was one of the dealers in the neighborhood. Now, this isn't a high-up level person, but one of the dealers in the neighborhood. And I kind of got concerned, because I'm wondering, why is he coming to see me? And then I wondered, were there some issues? And then there was a side of me that felt righteous, because I figured, you know, I'm the Pharisee. Excuse me, Christian. Did I say Pharisee? Oh, I'm the Christian, and he's the drug dealer. I mean, you know, he's the enemy. He's the people we're trying to get rid of. I mean, I was going, all this stuff was kind of going through, and then I got scared again. I said, why is he here? Well, I'm in really in trouble. And anyway, he kind of beat around the bush, and we had this conversation that wasn't going anywhere. And I mean, at some point, I just kind of said, is there something you'd like to talk with me some way? Either I can be of some help or support. And this led to a series of conversations that went on over a long period of time. I'm collapsing it, but it went over a long period of time. And eventually he said to me, he said, "I want out." And like an idiot, I said, "Out of what?" And he basically said, "I want out of this drug world." And now I was really out of my element now, because I said, "Well, you know, have you thought about," I said, I know the police precinct. I'm kind of chaplain to them. And so I said, "Could we talk with them about, you know, you can go into, witness protection." He said, "You've been watching too much TV." he was not high up, not that significant. I mean, so that wasn't going to work. And we had this conversation. I really couldn't figure out I said, "I don't know how to get you out of this. I mean, I just don't know." And I finally said, "I don't know." And he said, "Well, what about Jesus?" I said, "Who?" And he said, "What about Jesus?" And I'm thinking, I mean, I love the Lord, but I'm not quite sure how this is going to affect. He said, "I want to know more about this Jesus." I mean, I was stunned. And that led to a series of conversations where he shared his life story, and I shared some of mine, and we read the Gospel of Mark, if I remember correctly, together, or at least parts of it, and talked about Jesus, what he taught, his spirit, and who he is now. And I remember the preconceived stereotypes that I had about him as the drug dealer melted away the more I heard his story. And I suspect some of his about me melted too. But I still didn't know how to get him out. And when we finished kind of a study, we studied parts of the Gospels over a period of time. He finally asked, could he be baptized? And we went over to the church, and I got a couple church folk. I mean, just normal church folk to be kind of witnesses, but to keep their mouths shut. But anyway, kind of witnesses. Had to be very selective about who I got in the congregation to do this, because some would tell everybody. We had a lot of evangelists. We used to call them gossips, but we had a lot of evangelists. But got the right folk, and we came, and we had baptized. They were baptized, and I'll never forget, because when I said, "Do you announce Satan and all the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God?" I got scared, because I realized that if he renounced Satan and the spiritual forces of wickedness that rebel against God, he might be sacrificing his life. It's the first time I said those words and actually was afraid for him. And he said, "I renounce him." "Do you renounce the evil powers that draw you from the love of God?" "I renounce them." "Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior?" "I do." "Do you put your whole trust in his grace and love?" "I do." "Do you promise to follow and obey him as your Lord?" "I do. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." And then I dipped my thumb in the oil and made the sign of the cross. "You are sealed by the Holy Spirit in baptism and marked as Christ's own forever." And I realized he was out. He was free. "You are Christ's own forever. No matter what this world says about you, no matter what this world does to you, you are Christ's own forever." And he was free. And it happened as I heard his story, and he heard my story, and we met the story of Jesus. Oh, I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell that old, old story of Jesus and his love. My brothers and sisters, I'm going to sit down and shut up now, but I got to tell you, this Jesus of ours, this God of ours, this Lord of ours, he's real, and his love is real, and it can transform lives, and it can lift you up when the gravity of reality would pull you down. So don't you give up on this Jesus. Don't you be ashamed to stand up for this Jesus and his way of love, his way of kindness, his way of compassion, his way of goodness. Stand up, Episcopalians. Straighten out your back. Lift up your heads, Fort Worth. You follow Jesus. And his way is the way of the cross. And the way of that cross is the way of a love that will never let us go. God love you. God bless you. And may God hold us all in those almighty hands of love. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. All right. God love you. God bless.